Hello everyone. INE is an international trading platform open to global investors. Our goals are to capture and supply the demand situation in the industrial market and to provide producers, distributors, consumers, and investors with tools for price discovery, risk management, and asset management, in order to make the allocation of commodities and resources more efficient and the economy stronger. As a part of INE, we at the Market Compliance Department are responsible for maintaining an open, fair, and impartial market environment for all investors. As investors, you must be curious about what we do. In today's presentation, you will get a glimpse of the market supervision at INE. We will start with the regulatory frameworks. In particular, what domestic or foreign regulatory frameworks should an investor comply with? The domestic framework can be put into two broad categories, laws and regulations, and INE rules based on the issuing entities. Laws and regulations are issued by the legislative body and the government. The futures law will be the highest law governing China's futures market, but right now it is still under drafting. Before the law is introduced, the regulation of the administration of futures trading issued by the State Council has the highest authority. In addition, the government agencies have issued judicial interpretations on insider trading and divulgation of insider information. The administrative regulations and normative documents issued by CSRC include the measures for the administration of futures exchanges, measures for the supervision and administration of futures firms, and measures for the administration of futures practitioners, etc. Of particular relevance to overseas investors is interim measures for the administration of overseas traders and overseas brokers' engagement in the trading of specified domestic futures products. This is also futures industry's first administrative regulations specific to overseas investors. INE rules are made by INE itself. INE has developed the general exchange rules based on its articles of association and futures contracts. And this rule is complemented by 10 detailed implementing rules. Among them, the risk management rules and the enforcement rules are the common reference for the Market Compliance Department when handling trading violations and imposing penalties. In terms of cross-border supervision and cooperation, CSRC is a member of ILSFO. Any violator of INE rules, whether it's a domestic investor or an overseas investor, will first receive the self-regulatory penalties imposed by INE. If an overseas investor violates China's administrative regulations, INE will refer the case to CSRC, and CSRC will cooperate with the regulatory authority in the country or region where the overseas investor is situated, according to the MMOU. So, as a trading client, what risks will you face during futures trading on INE? As a matter of fact, risks are present in all phases of trading, starting as soon as you try to open an account. By phase of trading, we classify those risks into account risks, day-to-day trading risks, and delivery month risks. Account risks include risks from real name account, reporting ACR accounts, and reporting program trading. Day-to-day trading risks include risks from abnormal trading behaviors, trading violations, and position management, etc. Delivery month risks include risks arising from the exit of natural person clients delivery qualification. I will now explain each of them in details. The characteristics of real name account system are opening accounts through CFMMC by all participants, centralized custody of merchant funds, and unique trading code. To open an account as a corporate client, the agent is required to provide the power of attorney, his or her ID card, and other required account opening documents. In our day-to-day supervision, we often see the clients open accounts with other identity documents or do not keep their information up to date. This all brings a high level of legal risks. Therefore, we remind clients to properly manage their accounts, take care to identify illegal and disguised futures trading, and make sure that their accounts will not be used for margin lending or money laundering. Then let's talk about the actual control relationship. Actual control refers to the action of ability of a person, an individual or institution to control or to significantly influence the trading decisions of another person through the power to manage, to use, and to receive income from or dispose of the futures account of the latter person. By the principle of substance over form, a person is identified as having actual control over the trades executed through the futures account of another person if the first person is the controlling shareholder of the latter person, defined as any person whose contribution represents 50% or more of the total contribution in the latter person, or any shareholder who holds 50% or more of the total shares of the latter person, or any shareholder who, despite having a contribution or shareholding at less than 50%, can nevertheless exercise the voting rights granted by its contribution or shareholding to significantly influence the decisions of the shareholders' meeting or shareholders' general meeting of the latter person. The second is the first person is the authorized person for account opening, authorized trader, authorized person for funds transfer, settlement statement verifier, or any other person acting with the authority of the latter person. The third is the first person is the legal representative, principal, partner, director, supervisor, senior manager at Centra, or shares the same legal representative, principal, partner, director, supervisor, or senior manager at Centra of the latter person. The fourth is the first person is the spouse of the latter person. The fifth is the first person is a parent, child, or sibling of the latter person and has the decision-making power or a significant influence over the day-to-day trades made through the futures account of the latter person. The sixth is the first person has a decision-making power or a significant influence over the day-to-day trades made through the account of other persons through investment, contractual or financing agreement or other agreements. The seventh is the first person has the decision-making power or a significant influence over the day-to-day trades made through two or more futures accounts of the latter person, or the eighth is under any other circumstance identified by INE. We advise clients to report ACR accounts voluntarily and in advance. Clients should report these accounts to CFMMC through futures firm within 10 trading days of signing the futures brokerage contract. Overseas special non-brokerage participants should report them to CFMC through INE. If INE finds a suspected but unreported actual control relationship during day-to-day supervision, it will inquire the client concerned through the carrying member. If the client acknowledges the existence of ACR, it should fire account information according to the established procedures. If the client denies it, it should submit an explanation and sign a statement and undertaking to the effect. Clients who do not truthfully report ACR accounts may be penalized by corresponding regulatory measures of INE. In severe circumstances, the clients will be penalized according to the INE enforcement rules. INE treats ACR accounts as one account for various management purposes. Accordingly, when enforcing rules such as position limit, trading limit, and administration of abnormal trading behaviors, trades and positions of these accounts are counted on aggregated basis. You should also report program trading to INE through your futures firm, as INE has tools in place for identifying this type of activities. Depending on the severity of circumstances, INE may take actions against a client that does not report program trading fully or timely. If those actions have undermined the security of INE system or the normal course of trading. Therefore, we'd like to emphasize the importance of thoroughly testing the program trading system and knowing the various functionalities of the trading software. Next, once you actually start to trade, you will have to be careful about risks from abnormal trading behaviors, trading violations, and position management. Abnormal trading behaviors include self-trade, frequent order cancellation, frequent large order cancellation, combined position over limit by accounts linked by ACR, opening more positions in a single day than permitted, program trading that affected the market order, and other circumstances identified by CSRC or INE. The criteria for determining abnormal trading behaviors are given out in our slides. There are also exceptions, namely self-trades, frequent order cancellation, and frequent large order cancellation resulting from hedging. FOK orders and FAK orders will not be considered as a trading abnormality. Now for these different types of abnormal trading behaviors, INE responds differently in the case of self-trade, frequent order cancellation, and frequent large order cancellation. We were first alert by firm, and for the second time, circulate a public notice in the member service system, or if you are an overseas special non-brokerage participant, we will directly arrange a meeting with your senior officers. At the third occurrence, you will be suspended from opening new positions for at least 1 month or for at least 3 months if you are an OSMBP. In the case of combined position over limit by accounts linked by ACR, we will require the client to close out positions within the first trading session on the next trading day, or we will carry out forced liquidation and suspend the client for opening new positions for 1 month. In addition, at the first occurrence, we will circulate a public notice in the member service system. At the second occurrence, suspend the privilege to open new positions for 10 trading days, and at the third occurrence, suspend the privilege for 6 months. In the case of opening more positions in a single day than permitted, we will suspend the client from opening new positions from the next trading day for no less than 3 trading days. Trading violations come in various forms. Today, I will just give 4 examples. The first is influencing the settlement price, which means a client is attempting to make the final settlement price to move in its favor by wash trading or pre-arranged trades. This is mainly achieved by self-trades or pre-arranged trades among accounts linked by ACR, or closing out both long and short positions at the same time to cause significant price fluctuation. The second common type of trading violation is creating and spreading false information for manipulation of public sentiment. This refers to the act of fabricating or twisting information and propagating it to influence the futures trading, thus disrupting the futures market and causing other grave consequences. Next is spoofing, by which we mean that the violator would frequently submit and cancel orders or large orders, not for the purpose of entering into a trade, but influencing the trading price or volume, so that he can enter into a reverse trade or obtain illegal gains. The fourth type involves licensed industry employees, generally referring to those accredited to work as a professional at a regular or special organization. In relation to them, trading risks mainly stem from taking advantage of their positions to engage in pre-arranged trades between an authorized account, most often a company account, and an account with themselves as the beneficiary, thereby harming the interests of their employer. There are 2 telltale signs of this type of violations. First, in most cases, the violator would be trading between those 2 types of accounts, usually a company account and a personal account, to shuffle funds. Second, the violator would often choose less active contracts to ensure successful funds movement. In conclusion, there are 4 common types of trading violations. In recent years, we are seeing other types popping up as the market expands. Therefore, we'd like to take this opportunity to remind everyone to abide by INE rules to avoid unnecessary risks. The other thing that you and your broker should keep in mind while trading is properly managing your positions at all times. For example, INE implements variable margin requirement, meaning that a contract will have different trading margin requirement based on which stage it is in during its life cycle. There will also be price limit, which can be raised or lowered based on market conditions, and daily mark-to-market. So if a client has insufficient margin, its futures firm will require to deposit sufficient funds or to close out its position in a timely manner. You also have to watch for limit locked market. If a limit locked market occurs to a contract, INE will increase the price limit and margin requirement. Therefore, this type of situation requires clients to carefully manage their funds and futures positions. Variable position limit. A client who needs to hold a large position should apply for hedging or arbitrage quota in advance. Large trader reporting, a client should file a report when the combined same direction general and arbitrage position reach 100% of the position limit or 60% for overseas intermediaries. So clients may be interested in the large trader reporting procedure. I will get back to that shortly. Lastly, there is the forced liquidation of excess positions. A client may exceed the position limit for many reasons, including not reducing their positions fast enough when the limit changes. Mismanaging the total positions held by ACR accounts, resulting in a combined position over limit, or even involuntarily if the position limit is defined as the percentage of the open interest and the open interest itself declines. Large trader position reporting. Let's first look at the reporting threshold. As I just mentioned, a member or client should submit a report when its speculative positions in a futures contract reach 100% of INE speculative position limit or 60% for overseas intermediaries or when required by INE. This report mainly concerns the futures and cash positions of the member or client. For a client, the report should be submitted through its futures firm before 3 p.m. by the next business day within the next trading day. Clients like you don't need to be overly concerned with specific procedures for submitting the report. But for the record, first, INE will enter notice into member service system. Upon receiving them, members will in turn notify their clients and check the material prepared by clients before forwarding them to INE for review. Members are required to make sure the client's materials are truthfully and accurate and to properly preserve relevant documentations, such as original documents with client signatures and call recordings. INE may verify the contents of these reports from time to time. The third broad category of risk is delivery month risks. This mainly involves the exit of natural person clients, a unique feature of the Chinese futures market. And of course, the risks are associated with delivery. By exit of natural person clients, we mean that individuals who are unable to issue or accept the tax invoices required by IME must fully close out their positions in a delivery month contract by the specified trading day. If the positions are not terminated by that point, IME will carry out forced liquidation. The exit of natural person clients is a mechanism tailor-made for China's futures market, which is dominated by retail investors. We recommend overseas individuals to exit from contracts approaching the delivery months as early as possible. Doing so will help them avoid potential price fluctuation and order execution difficulties when people are trying to close out their positions en masse. In addition, as the exit date varies from product to product, clients are advised to find out the exact date in advance. To take part in the delivery process, you should ensure that you have the delivery qualifications. First, you need to open an account for INE Standard Warrant Management System and ensure you have a valid password. Second, you must be an institutional client and be able to issue or accept VAT invoices. In addition, you should be mindful of the risk of delivery default. A delivery default will take place if the seller cannot deliver the specified quantity of standard warrants within the delivery period, or if the buyer cannot take full delivery payment within the delivery period, or both. As a general advice, we encourage you to learn about the delivery procedure before you enter the delivery process. If you think there might be a delivery risk, you can also choose to exit your position through EFP. In those earlier slides, we've shown the compliance risks you may face during futures trading. You may be wondering how the market compliance department spots these risks and potential issues during the course of trading to protect clients' interests. So next, we will talk about our investigation process and the tools we use. There are five phases between case identification and closure. The process begins with system warning, upon which we will start an investigation. During the process, we will analyze data, look for past related incidents, open a formal investigation, and finally impose penalties as appropriate. Throughout all this, we use technologies to help us find the orders, execution data, market sentiments, system warnings, and historical data that are of interest to investigated events. And we'll build a chain of evidence based on this research, as well as whistleblowing reports and on-site inspection, and to support our conclusion and decision. Regulatory technology is one of the primary tools we use in market supervision, and that in turn relies on robust infrastructures. At this time, INE runs three supervision systems. Two of them, the real-time monitoring system and the historical data analysis system, are developed in-house based on the characteristics of the Chinese futures market. They help us detect abnormal and specific trading behaviors based on our monitoring criteria and data analysis results. In addition, in 2016, we introduced SMARTS, a system widely used in international markets. It has a powerful visualization function that can accurately recreate the entire trading process. Its use has brought our supervisory capabilities closer to leading international standards. So, these are my understanding of how market supervision works at INE. It's been my pleasure to share them with you. If you have any questions, comments, or even different views, please feel free to contact me, and you can reach me by my email. Thank you for listening, and I wish you a success in trading at INE.